Hello and welcome. My name is Kia and I'm coming to you from Sweden in my garden. And I think I have chosen the warmest day of this summer to record this podcast. Today it will be a special episode where I will give you some inspiration and tips of what to knit from your handspun yarn. And in Sweden we are it's a Swedish podcast and they are using the hashtag in Swedish now, Använd handspunnet, for you use your handspun yarn. And that's a hashtag that's existing on Instagram already. But so, inspired from the Swedish podcast Hemstickat that is encouraging us to knit from handspun yarn, I wanted to show you some of my projects that I have been spinning and knitting of my handspun yarn. So, I was a little bit confused when I was picking out projects to show you. And what is inspiring and what can I show you? And I have just picked out some of my handspun projects, and that's also scary because I have so much more. But we shall just start with what I have brought out to you, and this will be something will be both if there is only handspun yarn, but I will also show you projects where I have mixed handspun yarn with commercial yarns. And don't be afraid to do so, because the point of hand spinning is to use it. So this will be a little cavalcade of things that I want to encourage you to perhaps knit from your handspun yarn, or knit if you're not a hand spinner. You can perhaps get inspired to use up small skeins of yarns that you have laying around, because that's one of the problems with being a hand spinner, is that we often end up with this 100 grams of this and 200 grams of that, seldom the sweater quantities. So this is a cavalcade of things that I have picked together and mixed to get bigger quantities. So the first thing I want to show you today is a pair of mittens and mitts, wrist warmers perhaps. And this is a small nice project to begin with if you are just starting and you want to use up for something. A pair of wrist warmers is an easy project and will not use up so much yarn, and also inspiring to perhaps use different small bits and pieces of handspun yarn. So this is a pattern by Linnea Ornstein, and I will write the name here. I think it's Earia or something. Earina perhaps. And I have knitted these from it's a spin that I did for the Kingfisher Word in the Lost Word book. I started up with this one. And after this one, I also ended up with a big shawl, but we will get to that later on. But this is a little tips if you have handspun yarn laying around, small bits and pieces, and you can use different yarns for the different buds here, I think. So that's a small project to begin with. The next project I want to show you, that's also a pair of mittens. That's the Pebble Mitts. And this is a pattern of my own. And I decided to knit, after knitting a big shawl in these yarns, I decided I wanted a matching pair of mitts. So I used up the same kind of yarn. And this is a little bit thicker yarns, but it's okay. It worked fine for the pattern. So this is such a good project if you have a variegated handspun yarn and you don't know what to do with it. Combine it with the solid color. This is my handspun, the gray also. But if you have if you don't have solid color handspun, you could use commercial yarn here and just let the variegated yarn be in the background like this. Super beautiful. And here you can use one, if you don't have so much, you can use one variegated yarn here and one on the hand. And this is a pattern from my Ravelry store, and I will link it. And I think it's I think this is actually a free pattern on my website, but I will be linking to it. So the pebble mitts are also a very small project, and you don't have to have so much yarn to just get started and use your handspun yarn. The shawl I was knitting before I knitted the pebble mitts, I knitted a big shawl in my handspun yarn, and this was so inspiring to go up to my handspun yarn stash and just pick out this plant dyed really natural vibes of colors and knit a big shawl. And I think I have like 6-8 stitches here in the beginning, and then I did the increases on outside of these stitches, and then I have just knitted and mixed and matched and made a super big shawl from this handspun yarn stash that I have. And I was so happy, and I'm still happy with this one. It's a little bit on the thicker side, I should say perhaps 250 meters per 100 grams. And I had a lot of this gray fine wool, and fine wool is a breed in Sweden, so it's not fine wool, it's fine wool is a Swedish breed. And this gray is so beautiful, and I used the lace from the Hanselhapp by Gudrun Jonsson to finish this shawl off, and it's so cozy, and you can wrap really. I'm a sort of bigger person, but I can really feel I'm drowning in this one. It's so cozy, really cozy. So really big, lovely shawl, and I can tie it in the back as well. But there is no real pattern for this one. It's just something that I made up as I knitted it, and ended it with a lace border like that. And I think that there is patterns on Ravelry that's similar to this one. What's it called? The Danish Bindershawl is a free pattern on Ravelry, and it's sort of similar to this one. So that's the shawl I knitted, and then I knitted the mitts to match with that shawl. Okay, so we are into shawls, and we are into using up small bits and pieces of yarns that we have handspun that's just laying there. This is another perfect project for bits and pieces of your handspun yarn. And this is Night Shift Shawl by Andrea Mauri. And I remember being so obsessed. I have been, what do you call it? I was in a fiber club with Hilltop Cloud in the UK. And I got fibers every month coming. Subscription. To a monthly fiber club, and I think I was for over a year, and I just kept on putting the beautiful fibers in a box, and by that time I was not an experienced spinner, so I went to that box, and I just picked out a lot of different colors and started to spin. And I'm not sure if I'm lying to you if I say that I spun and knit this in 2 weeks, because I was so obsessed. And yeah, all the beautiful mixing with the yellow, purple, blue, pink. It's so much fun. Really fun. And it's a quite big shawl, and you can use it as both over the shoulders and also wrapped around like this in the front. But yeah, this is a perfect, if you have been spinning a lot of different fibers and you don't know what to do with it, this is perfect, because it didn't take much of each color, so you could just mix and match. And it doesn't have to be. I know that in the pattern it says this amount of that color and this amount of that color, but it's really just mix and match. If the one color that she says has to have 50 grams and you only have 30, pick in another color. It will be fine. It will not be any different. So the Night Shift shawl by Andrea Mowry is a perfect shawl for your handspun yarn. And there is the Night Shift sweater, and there is the Shifty is the sweater. Yeah, there is also a cowl in this style. So if you don't have the patience or the amount of yarn to knit a big shawl, perhaps the cowl will be a good start. So that's the Night Shift shawl by Andrea Mowry. I have been spinning a lot of my friend Emma Garnbyrån. She is dyeing on different kinds of fiber types, and I have been experimenting a lot with how to spin the fibers that she is dyeing. I am doing fractal, I am doing gradients, and different ways of attacking her fibers. And this was a fractal spin that I did from one of her wool wheels, and this is merino silk, so it's so soft. And it was 200 grams, and I decided to use it as the body of my connection shawl. And this is a pattern that I have designed, and it's for sale on Ravelry, so I will link to this one in the description, or if I put up the links on my website, I'm not sure. But it's a big shawl. It was designed to be knitted in Nordlys, the sock yarn, but after knitting it in Nordlys, I wanted to make one in my handspun yarn as well. So this is so beautiful with the variegated yarn, and also with this big cable that you knit the body of this shawl, and then you connect the cable at the end here. So that's why I call it connection shawl. So this is half of it. So you see it's a big wrap, and you put it over your shoulders, or you put it around your neck and be really cozy. So this is also two different spins. So first I spun this gradient fractal spin, and then I had a solid color here. Yeah, there is a solid color here at the border. So combining two different kinds of fibers that you have. I'm not sure if I'm very seldom a spinner who spins for a project. I spin the fiber as I want it, and then I have a look at what I have been spinning, and then I combine them to a certain project. So I'm not a spinner who plans ahead. I just go for the fibers, what the fiber wants to be spun like, and it's also a matter of my spirit at the time I'm spinning. If I am calm, I can perhaps spin thinner, and if I'm stressed, I will just it all comes out in the fiber. So that's also spinning in memory in yarn, and knitting in memories in the project. Yes, but this is, if you have, this was 200 grams, I think, and this was not quite 200 grams. Yeah, one of my own designs knitted up in my handspun yarn. Really beautiful. And if you want to, you can always knit these projects in commercial yarns as well. So not only handspun is good for it, but this is an inspiring podcast just to inspire you of what you can do with your handspun yarn. So this was a gradient spin that I did, and I'm not sure if I actually planned this ahead. Perhaps I did, but this was a big gradient fiber, and it was from blue, and then it turned into orange, and then it turned back to blue again. And I actually ended up I did spin one half at a time, but when I was plying it, I realized that this won't fit into the bobbin, so I just had to break it. So the first blue is I stopped and I made a skein, and then the orange came and I made a skein, and then the last blue part came and I also made that. So it was actually turned into three skeins in the end. But yeah, looking at it now, using the blue like this and the orange, I'm so glad that I decided to spin this as a gradient and not as a fractal. And the difference between fractal and gradient is that you try to keep it together, the blue with the blue and the orange with the orange. And if you spin a fractal, you split the fibers in half, and then the first half is kept as it is, and the second half is splitted up to small pieces. So the color changes will come more often on that side, and that's the more like spin cycle yarn style. But yeah, I'm glad I kept it, the blue and the orange separated like this. And it looks like the bottom of the ocean, don't you think, with the plants that's growing in the bottom of the ocean. And the sea that's variegated, the water is shifting in colors. So, so beautiful. This is one of my proudest things I have spun and knitted, I think. It's like art. And yes, it's Ramsan by Linnea Ornstein, and it's the same designer as for the wrist warmer. So I have a beautiful kit here for autumn. I'm really happy to be wearing this when the weather cools down a bit. So that's also something that you could knit, and you don't have to plan it ahead like I did. You can just pick up something that you have. Perhaps you have some commercial yarn for the background, and then you can do some and for the buds here and for the leaves, you can use any colors of yarn. Of your hand spun yarn. It's so beautiful when they change in colors like this. So yes, that's the Ramsan shawl and the Erina, I think, Erina mitts. So I also actually sometimes spin with the intention of making a project. And I made a video when I started up. It was blue face Leicester and nylon, and how I splitted it and how I spun it and plied it and all the full project to making a pair of socks. And this is a 3-plied yarn, chain plied, and made into a pair of simple socks. But when you are spinning for socks, I really recommend you to perhaps try to be a little bit more intentional. 3-plying or give your 2-ply a really high twist. That's something that I recommend. And also knit on a tight gauge, because that will give them longer life. They are well worn, I must say. So this is a 3-plied yarn, chain plied, and yeah, they turned out really nice. And there is no, I'm wearing them a lot indoors at the evenings when it gets cold, and they have not worn out yet, so that's really good. Also fibers from Emma, and this is also fibers from Emma. All the hand-dyed fibers here are from my friend Emma. And this was a pair of socks that I knitted, and this was not a 3-ply. This is a 2-plied blue face Leicester nylon that I spun up and knitted into a pair of socks as an experiment to see how they will hold up. And so far I am also using them as indoor slippers more of over the summer, but they are holding up quite well. No sign of wear here. And for this, it's just my own patterns. There is nothing special with a pair of simple socks. 2x2 ribbing here. I made 2x2 ribbing on the heel just for fun, and also for the toe, just to match up And this is all just for fun, just experimenting. These were made with the slip stitches over the heel flap here to make it more wearable, more sturdy. So that's the mitts, the shawls and the socks. And we are now moving into the sweaters, because I have knitted a lot of sweaters from my handspun yarn actually. And I want to just give you some inspiration for handspun small skeins that you have laying around, perhaps leftovers or small spins or something. This was a sweater that I designed this year, and it's called Stripey Heaven. And I have been using, it's just knit stitches, it's not ribbing, it's knit stitches playing with the dominant colors in the yoke here, and using up just I think I had just 100 grams of each perhaps of this yarns, and then using them as a funny contrasting in the yoke, and then striping the body and ending up with this stripy border both at the bottom of the sleeves and the body. And I also had some of my first in the beginning when I wasn't so well in spinning, some yarns ended up thicker than others, and I decided to use the thicker yarn that I made into the I-cord edge at the bottom here, because it doesn't matter if that's a little bit thicker, it just gave it a better drape at the end. So you will just have to find the best place for for your handspun yarn. And this is all handspun, and different, not exactly the same thicknesses, but on the thinner side anyway. So that's some kind of inspiration, and there is a lot of patterns that looks similar to this. My thinking when I made this sweater, it's not a pattern that I have been writing down, but if you have the anchor sweater, you can use that numbers of stitches or increasing in the yoke, and then make a stripy body. So the anchor sweater is a yoke that I think about because it's so cleverly done, and I will not give away the numbers of the yoke, but if you know how to make a raglan yoke with the increases two on each and every other row, two stitches on each and every other row, that gives you eight stitches on each and every other row, and then you just do the math. So if there is 10 rounds between increases, just do the math, how many stitches did I increase if I would have made a raglan, and so on, and that will give you a good fit for the yoke. And then there is discussions, of course, how to place the increases on the yoke, but I'm just saying, do the math here. A raglan yoke is a good numbers to go from, and there is different, of course, with thicknesses of yarns, but with the raglan, that's so clever, because if you have a thick yarn, the stitches are bigger, and the increases, they go quicker, so the garment will be bigger quicker. And with a thin yarn, it will take longer time, but also the increases come closer then. So it is super clever with the raglan. And if you just use the raglan numbers when you plan a yoke, you will end up fine. So that's the first thing that I want to just inspire you to pick out all your different small skeins of handspun and put together in a stripey heaven, I call it. And no pattern, just having fun. In Sweden we have a designer called Erika Åberg, and she has a pattern called Austasjön, and I have showed it to you before, and I just love this yoke. And in Sweden, it's very, very popular. Everybody's knitting the Alstasjön sweater. And I decided when I got the book, I wanted to make it in my handspun yarn. So I picked together this as well. It's just, I picked the bigger amount of yarn that I knew that I needed more of course. So I placed them where there was a need for more yardage, and then the leftovers or the small skeins are used up in the yoke. And yeah, this is also so when I came to the body, I realized, because in the pattern the body is in one color, but I realized I don't have that much yarn, yardage of any yarn. So I went for a lifted stitches pattern, and that means that you on one round knit one round with gray, and then on the next round when you come to your where you are perhaps a little bit more short of yarn, you just lift each, you knit one and you lift one, you knit one, you lift one, so that way you will end up with a fabric that looks like this. And I made corrugated ribbings for the bottom, because I didn't have that much yarn left, not in the sleeves. So as you can see, I am not afraid of doing what will mix up. This is a light one, this is a gray one, this is a corrugated rib one. I don't care. I just want to have fun when I knit. I want to use up my handspun, and I want to, yeah. I love this look. I'm not a perfectionist. I'm not looking for the perfect sweater. I'm looking for using up my handspun and making me happy. So, yeah, this is Alstasjön by Erika Åberg. I'm not sure if this one is translated into English. I don't think so. But there is a lot of other sweaters like that. And I can see many sweaters that will go very well like this. Lunenburg pullover, Badger and Bloom by Anne Wenzel. Lunenburg is by Amy Kristoffersson. So there is a lot of similar patterns out there that you can just use up what you have. A couple of years ago, I was also in a spinning kick, and I found a pattern by Kate Davis that was called Triet. And this was my this was also a spin that I did in a very short time, and I just, after spinning, I cast it on right away. I had to make some calculations here, because this sweater is knitted in a thinner yarn than I made from my handspun. But I just calculated, I went, I think, down a couple of sizes, and then I just knitted, and it turned out perfectly. It's a lovely, lovely sweater, short-sleeved sweater that I can wear indoors when it's autumn and winter. But for this 30 degrees weather, it's not quite the sweater I would choose, actually. But this would be nice to knit in a linen yarn, perhaps. But yeah, did the spin and the knit very short, in a very short time, because when I get excited about something, I just go for it. So make the pattern work for your handspun yarn. And this is only, I think this is Ashford Blend Cinnamon. And it's with silk, so it really glitters in the sun. Super beautiful. So this is also a sweater I did in my handspun yarn. Yeah, last year I designed a sweater, and this is part of my top-down collection, No Limits. And for my patrons, there is, all my patterns are for free on my Patreon site. So if you decide to join my Patreon, you will get all these patterns for free. And yeah, this is not available if you're not a if you're not a Patreon, I'm sorry, they are not available. But this is what I'm talking about with the raglan. You just cast on, figure out for your yarn for your yarn that you're using, the number that you need to cast on here. Do the raglan, and then you can just figure out something fun. Here there is stripes in pearl stitches, and then I'm ending the border with this wavy edge. So this is Smiling Waves. And the light color here in the background is my handspun yarn, and it's spun really thin. And yeah, in a baby pastel-y colors. So I wanted something contrasty just to tone that down, or to brighten it up, you should say, perhaps. So I chose a commercial burgundy yarn and just striped it and used it as this border. So the bottom color is handspun and the contrasting color is commercial. And don't be afraid to mix. I know a lot of people have problems with mixing handspun with commercial, but I think it's better to mix than to not use them at all. So for this, it was a perfect project for me. If I'm supposed to wait for the spin that comes that will be perfect for this contrasting color, perhaps my inspiration to knit this sweater will be gone. So this is a sweater that came to me last year. And for those of you who have been here a long time, you know that it is a special one. It was after my surgery, and yeah, really, really happy that the surgery went well. So that's why I'm calling it Smiling Waves. But yeah, mix handspun and commercial, that's totally fine. Just to use up the handspun yarn. Find the project and just go for it. Another project that I also have been mixing my handspun yarn with some commercial yarn is a spin that I did with my handspun and one strand of mohair. And this is a design by Tiff Nealon, and I can't really remember the name of it, but I will write it here on the screen. It was a pattern that was included in one of the Line magazines. Ascend, now it comes to me, Ascend it's called. And it's with a structured motif at the end here. And then just stockinette, and with this standing up color, really, really beautiful. And oversized and really nice. And also, of course, very, very hot, because it's stranded with mohair. And my handspun wasn't really so thin here. So, yeah, a beautiful sweater, and also very lovely in the transitioning from autumn perhaps to winter, or autumn, because yeah, they are 3/4 length sleeves. But knit yourself a long pair of wrist warmers, and you can use them up to the arm bow here, and then you can easily use 3/4 length sleeves with your longer wrist warmers. So I made, perhaps you follow my podcast as well, and I made recently a pair of handspun wrist warmers that came up to the arm bow, and they will be perfect for this sweater when it comes a little bit closer to autumn. So as you can see, there is a lot of things that you can do with your handspun yarn. And I want to show you the latest one that I finished. Is a shawl from, I haven't yet showed you this in the podcast, but I was joining my friend Emma Garnbyron in her fiber club inspired by the ocean. And I spun up a fiber that's inspired by blue mussel. I'm not sure what you call it, ocean mussel perhaps. It's the blue mussel with the pearls, mother of pearl colors inside the shell. So it's really, really beautiful. And I wanted this yarn to just shine for itself. So I found a shawl pattern in this book, Ego Strick by Lena Holme Samsø. And the pattern is quite simple, actually. It's It's looking like this in the beginning. Here she shows when she was experimenting with different kinds of starts for the shawl. And they come in two sizes, so they both start like this, but mine doesn't make so many increases, so I keep it narrow. But there is also option here that you start to do a lot of increases, so you get a bigger shawl like this. But I decided to go for the smaller one that's more like a scarf. And I wasn't sure how much yarn I would use, because yeah, when you do with your handspun, you can't really follow the instructions of the yardage and so on in the pattern. But this is how it turned out. So you start up here and you do increases in the little tags at the end. And then when you decide that I'm halfway, and I think this is halfway, and I just started to do decreases at the end here. So I think that my blue muscle is showing up quite nicely in this pattern. And this is the kind of scarf that I tend to use a lot of, because I'm having problems with how to style the big shawls. But with these small ones, they are just like neck warmers, and I think that this one will come to a lot of use, actually. And you can just place these tags as you want to, if you want them to show or not. This is used 135 grams, and you can make it more narrow, or you can make it shorter, or the option is yours. You can also just knit this. You don't have to decide when you come to the middle and then start to decrease. You could just knit till it stops, till the yarn ends, and then bind off, because that's also it will turn out like this more. But that's also an option. But yeah, really simple. And I think the hitchhiker shawl is something similar to this one, but it doesn't decrease at the end. So if you're looking for something similar, I don't think that this book is translated into English, but something similar, just garter stitch and then doing these tags at the end. So the hitchhiker shawl is something looking like this. So that's my recent finished handspun project, actually. And I have been buying from a Swedish farmer. I bought 300 grams of brown alpaca and spun it up, and it was so beautiful fibers. And when I spun it, I did spin it not washing it. So I have ended up with a large skein here, and as you can see, I have spun it quite thin. And with this one, I knew I wanted to make a shawl. I was so certain when I started to spin it, and I realized that this is possible to spin as a thin thread. Not all fibers want to be spun as thin threads, but this one wanted to. And I spun and I thought I separated it in two, but when I was getting close to be finishing with the spinning, I left a pile of fibers, because I thought that perhaps this is enough, but it wasn't. So in the end, I just broke off one thread and made one big skein, and then I spun the rest up on the bobbin that was ended and made a small skein of that. And I have cast it on for a shawl, actually. And I was looking on hashtag lace shawl, and I was also searching on Ravelry for lace shawls, and something that came to me, pictures on Instagram, was the Moody Knitter. She has made a lot of lace shawls that was beautiful. So I went to her to her Ravelry store and looked around in her patterns. And I found one shawl that was really lovely, I thought. But then I looked at the shape of the shawl. I found the lace really lovely. But then I looked at the shape of the shawl and it wasn't what I was looking for. So I scrolled on and then I actually came to a big shawl with garter stitch at the beginning and then you end with a wide lace border at the end. And it was a free pattern and I will write the name here because I can't remember. But I decided to cast that one on and just try how will the yarn look and how will it feel, and I just wanted to get started and see how it will become. And I went down, I think the shawl is called for 3.25 millimeter needles, and I went down to 3 millimeter needles because I have actually spun a really thin thread here. I have over 1,000 meters of yarn, and I haven't counted it exactly, but somewhere over 1,000. So it's thin, and I went down to 3 millimeters, and I could perhaps knit in on 3.25, but I didn't find that needle, and 3.3 millimeters was fine. And it's an interesting shape. It's a four-row repeat. So you increase on every row and you decrease on one row of the four. So you end up adding three stitches on every four row. And that's giving you this shape. It's moving inwards here with one stitch on every four row. And it's moving out here three stitches on every four row. So yeah, you can keep on knitting this one as long as you want. Actually, the pattern says for a number of stitches, but if you look at the chart, you can just add one more chart if you want to make it bigger or smaller. Because this is also a shawl that I think that you can just use the number of the needle that you need for your handspun yarn and make it as big or as small as you want to, because you can just add one more chart or take away one more chart if you want to make it bigger or smaller. So if you should knit this one on 7 millimeter needles, it will grow quite quickly to a big shawl, and then you don't need perhaps 20 repeats of the chart. You can just use 10 perhaps or something. I'm just making up the numbers here, but you understand the point. You don't have to have a lace weight or a fingering weight yarn to make this shawl. You can make it with a thicker yarn like this perhaps, and then it will give a more rustic look, but you can still use the pattern if you can just do some math for yourself. So this is the handspun yarn that I have on my needles right now, and with this one I actually planned ahead, and I'm so surprised, because that's not something that I normally do. Normally I take the fiber and I start to spin. I plan if I want to do a fractal or if I want to do a gradient or if I just want to knit it, 2-ply, 3-ply, whatever, that much I have to plan. But I don't plan on the project at the end. That's new. No, I didn't do that. I didn't have a specific shawl in mind, but I had a shawl in mind. But when you start to work with the fiber, it really is on your personality and on your mood and on the fiber's wish what it wants to become. So we will just have to go with that inspiration or that feeling that we have when we work with the fiber. And then to have a big fiber stash to go and just dive into, and a handspun yarn stash, it's fantastic. And that will be another episode where I will bring out all my handspun yarn and we will have a look at it and see what can this be. So I hope that this gave you some inspiration, and perhaps if you're not the hand spinner, you can use the inspiration for your stash Anyway, you I'm sure you have a stash, and you can use up leftovers, you can use up small skeins, single skeins that you have, and perhaps I'm just giving you some kind of inspiration here of what to knit from your stash, hand spun or not. So if you think that this was inspirational and you want to support my work in any way, there will be links under here to coffee.com and to Patreon. And if you decide to join me over on Patreon, you will get access to the patterns that I have there for free. And this connection shawl is something that is paid for on Ravelry, but it is for free for my patrons. So if you decide to join me, you will have some patterns to choose from. This is also one of the patterns that is on my Patreon site for free. Okay, links. I will put up this video with links to everything I talk about today on my website kiaspo.se, and I will link over there. And I hope that you enjoyed this little video in the warmest day of the summer. Have a lovely time. I'm rambling. See you in the next podcast. Bye bye.